talking. We've been talking. I'm excited about continuing the series here, Chase the Lion, out of 2 Samuel. Story of Benaiah, who's a warrior that goes into this pit. And I'm sure that he's afraid. I wouldn't say he wasn't afraid, but he goes into this pit. The Bible says it was a snowy day, and he catches and he kills the lion. Of course, he killed some other warriors as well. And our whole series of Chase the Lion has sort of been based on this spirit of go get it, right? Go get more, that God wants more from me, from you. And even for the new year, we prayed that and we taught that way, and we're still going in that direction to say that this year, I want more from God. Don't you? I want more, whatever that means. And usually if you say, God, I want more from you, he's going to say, no problem, but that means I want more from you. And are we willing? Are we willing? So last week we spoke on reframing problems. And that was a great word. Pastor Ruben, where is he? There he's back there. Amen. Amen. Just saying, I'll text it to you later so that you have no question. But we talked about reframing problems, and it was excellent. If you missed it, go on YouTube. But it was about shifting our perspective to match God's. And that's a fantastic word, something to think about. And today we wanted to talk about embracing uncertainties. Embracing uncertainties. We have any daredevils in the house? Do we have any adrenaline junkies? Anybody snowboard or like cliff dive or whatever? We have a few. Y'all, first of all, y'all are nuts. You need prayer. You really truly need like release from that. But there's people that are like this. They're adrenaline junkies. And I saw this video. I can't imagine how he thought it up. I saw this video where a guy parachutes out of a plane on a mountain bike with a snowboard strapped to his back. All right, like where's he going? Take a bus. So anyway, so he parachutes to the bottom, and he lands, and I respect it a great deal. He lands rolling, the parachute snaps off somehow, and then eventually he's literally in mid, while he's riding, taking the board, like it's amazing, it's ridiculous. And it's pretty neat, it's also pretty crazy. But for most people, for most sane normal people, sorry for those of you who raise your hand, people don't like that kind of adrenaline rush. All the adrenaline rush I need is my wife and my two kids. I've got all the suspense, all the adrenaline I'm ever going to need. Oh, that I don't need to do anything. Hi, honey. No illustrations. I'm not going any further than that. I know you're watching me. But listen. And then, the children, all that. Most people don't like that adrenaline. They don't like the uncertainty. They don't like what's around the bend. If I'm riding a bicycle, I want to see exactly what's in front of me. And that uncertainty is what most people balk at. It makes you nervous. Doubt. Who wants to live with doubt? For many, it's terrifying. We need consistency. We need stability, right? That's what we crave. We need safety, comfort, all those things. And all you got to do is turn on the news to get suspense, honestly, today in this day and age. And so we need to know the mortgage is paid. We need to know that there's gas in the car. That's what we need to know. We need those certainties. We need those securities. And honestly, and again, because it's 2017, it goes further than that. We need to know our smartphone works. We need to know our cable is going to show the game that we want to see. There's more that it's not really a necessity, but we're looking for the certainty that, hey, I buy a dishwasher, that thing is going to work because I don't want to wash them. Certainty. You don't want doubt. You want your house to work. Everything has to work. Everything has to be. And that's fine. And I'll be honest with you. The truth is, I don't like surprises. I really don't. I mean, if I come home and like the lights are dimmed and there's like a nice meal going and the kids are like with somebody else. Wait, that's a different sermon. Anyway, the point is, and it's coming in a couple months. It is. Married people. So anyway, listen, I like that kind of surprise. But if it's a real big surprise, I'm not into it. I get all kinds of nervous. Several years ago, it was a great thing that she did. My wife surprised me with this trip. Now, I'd never been to Disney, and it was my 40th birthday. And Andrea surprised me with a trip to Disney. Now, the first thing that came into my head was, we don't have money like that. What are you doing? Right? So, but I'm gathered, like, there's people around me now. There's family. I can't panic in public. So she surprises me. She gave me this like little book, and it was all like done very creatively. And I opened it, and it took a while for it to dawn on me. We're going to Disney, right? And so I'm 40 years old, and I'm like, hee-hee-hee. But at the same time, I'm thinking, we can't afford. What about work? What about this? What about that? I can't do this. She had spoken to the pastor I was working with at the time. She had taken care of everything. But I'll be honest with you, until we actually got on the plane, I was still nervous. I was still thinking, we're missing something. You don't just pick up, because it was like 2 days later. I think it was my birthday, and then either the next day or the day after, I got to tell you, I was a mess. I was a hot mess thinking to myself, when I come back, something's going to be a disaster. But it wasn't. It wasn't. All went well. But the truth is, I wasn't crazy about surprises. I'm really not. So it did go good, but it turns out, as wonderful as it was, I still don't like surprises. It didn't change me at all. And there's, you know, even with spiritual things, there's doubts, there's uncertainties. It's not just the physical stuff. It's not just mortgage payments and things like this that are uncertain. It's spiritual things as well. Has anybody ever in here ever had spiritual doubt? Did God speak to me? Was that the right? Did I do the right? Any number of doubts that are spiritual doubts, where you're even going through a rough season, thinking, God, am I really? This is true. Maybe this is you, but have you ever felt, God, am I really saved? I think I am. You wake up one morning, you kind of don't know if you are or you're not. Spiritual doubt. Now, there shouldn't be any of that. Of that wondering if you're saved, because the Word of God says that His Holy Spirit will testify to you. It will talk to you. It will. There's supposed to be communication there. There's supposed to be relationship there. So when you hear somebody say, "Well, how do I know if I'm saved or not?" Well, did you pray the prayer? Then the Spirit of God should be talking to you. You should walk in that process, and you get closer to God. And the better you get to know somebody, the more communication there should be, and that's the way it works. God craves that. He craves just talking to you. He craves hearing you. That's what prayer is all about, and that's how faith is born. Faith comes by what? Hearing, right? And so we're in the Word, and we're in prayer, and faith is growing. And when it's talking about spiritual doubt, faith is what combats that. Faith is what combats that. And you all, I believe you all, or many of you know the verse in Hebrews 1:1. What is that? What is faith? Faith is what? It's a confidence in what we hope for and an assurance of something we don't see. That's faith. And that faith covers most of that spiritual stuff. Now, maybe I make a decision. I'm wondering where God is going to take me, whether I should do this or whether I shouldn't do this. God, I'm asking you, is this a yes or a no? Can I tell you something? 9 times out of 10, if you come to me and you say to me, Pastor, can you pray with me or give me some advice on whether I should buy this house or take this job or do that or move over here? 9 times out of 10, what I'll tell you is, if it makes sense and it looks good and your heart is right with the Lord, do it. Why? Because He's going to guide your footsteps. You remember the scripture, right? You're not left in this alone. The footsteps of the righteous are guided of God, right? So if I'm praying and I'm seeking the Lord and I'm serving Him and there's some great big question, I'm going to pray. I'm going to ask Him. I'm not going to go flippantly and do whatever I want to do, assuming He'll fix it later, although He can. I'm going to ask Him. But at the end of the day, sometimes when I want that big voice that says, do this, He doesn't say that. He doesn't give it to me. And so in the end, you use wisdom and you say, God, lead me. But you know that you're in relationship with Him, so you know that He's going to. And that's faith, and that dispels all of that spiritual doubt and uncertainty. And the trick is to remember that spiritual uncertainty will also remove that spiritual faith will also remove earthly uncertainty. Because what can happen here to damage me? Nothing. What's going to happen here that's going to make me panic? Nothing. I love my children. I might worry. I might a little. But in the end, everything is in the hands of God. So my spiritual faith will dispel both spiritual and earthly uncertainty. And that's what we're talking about today. That place of doubt. Now, that place of doubt is not all bad. What do you mean? I mean, if I knew everything right now, I'd be in trouble. Wouldn't you? If you knew the story the way that God knows the story, the Word of God says that God knows the beginning from the end. He knows it all. He knows the end from the beginning. I'm sorry. He knows it all. But I don't know that, right? And thank God that I don't know that. Who knows how I would act? So doubt is not all bad. So when people tell me, just so you know, and I want to come up to my first point here, when people tell me that this uncertainty, this doubt, it's not fun. I want to know where God is taking me. It's a control issue. It's a control issue. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be a control freak. Some of you, okay, you can stop saying it now. So some of you are like, yes! Yeah, no, don't do that. So anyway, and smirking and smiling. Anyway, okay, so listen. The truth is, when it comes to certainty and doubt, I want to say, God, tell it to me. Just tell me all I need to know. Tell me what I need to know right now. And God says, no, you'll trust me more if you depend on me. That's true. But there's more to it than that. There's more to it than that. It's beyond that. God is so creative, and he keeps things interesting. And guess what? By leaving you wondering, he makes our life more fun. And that's the truth. The fact that there's some uncertainty in my life makes it interesting, because I don't know where God is going to take me. I don't know what God is going to do with us. And I love that. For somebody to tell me that the Bible is boring tells me you don't know the Bible. For somebody to tell me that to walk in faith makes you nervous because you're afraid you might get bored tells me you don't understand God at all. Because his plan for you is to use you, to make you fruitful, yes, all of that. But it's to provide for you, my first point here, adventure. He loves you. He doesn't know how to keep you happy. He doesn't know how to give you the desires of your heart. Doesn't the Word tell me that? Doesn't the Word make it very clear that if I put my trust in him, doubts and all, uncertainty and all, doesn't the Word make it very clear to me that if I'm looking for him first, if I'm seeking him first, he'll give me everything else, everything that I need, and even some wants, amen? So number one, adventure. Not uncertainty, adventure. You remember what Jesus said to the people that were following him in Matthew? If you want to turn there, Matthew chapter 8, verse 20. Now, 2 Samuel is still our text, and the story of Benaiah has still been our text. It has been for weeks. But now we're going to just read this very quickly. Matthew chapter 8, verse 20. This is what Jesus said to those that were following him. The foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. Here's my translation. When you truly choose to follow Christ, there's no telling where he's going to lead you. And that's good. It's not bad. It's good. Anything can happen. And yes, that can feel scary. But if you're trusting in the Lord, it's only going to be better than what you and I plan. That's the truth. Let me read another scripture. Luke chapter 9, verse 57. And following here to verse 62, I guess. Luke chapter 9, verse 57. As they were, and it's the same verse in a different setting, different context. Luke 9, 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Which Jesus already knew. No, not wherever I go. But he says to him in verse 58, Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, the man, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. That seems like a good request, no? Seems fair, doesn't it? But there was more to it than that. That's not what the man was saying. He's saying, I have stuff. I can't follow you right now. Right? And keep reading. Verse 60, Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Let me tell you something. When Jesus says, let the dead bury their own dead, the Old Testament is full of link prophecy to this scripture about what it means for God to take what was dead and bring it back to life. It's astonishing to me. It's astonishing to me how someone can say, I'm afraid to trust God fully because I doubt what's going to happen. He takes dead things and brings them back to life. And in this verse, do you really know what he's saying? He's saying to this guy, let what's dead be dead. Let it stay dead. You don't need that. You follow me. You follow me. Let what's unnecessary remain unnecessary. Leave it behind you. Just come. And the man can't. The man can't. Let me continue on. Verse 61. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, and this is it. This is the key. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Have you ever seen a farm when they plow? All the rows are real nice. Corn, you know, corn rows. It's literally where you get that little expression for the hair, the corn rows. Why? Because they're straight. That's the idea. That's kind of the point. They're straight. And somebody who's ever been on a farm with my grandfather had this thing called a motozappa, which was a plow with an engine on it. And he drove a cart with it and all this. And it had these, and it was kind of precarious. It was very powerful, very powerful. But it was kind of precarious. The handles were real big. And I'll tell you, if you were in dirt going through something that offered a lot of resistance and you went like this, I guarantee you'd go crooked. So this makes a lot of sense when you say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to honor God. I'm really going to do this. I'm committing my heart to the Lord, whenever that was. And I pray that every person in this room has done that. But whenever you did that, you said, God, I'm going to enter into a relationship with you. I'm going to enter into service to you. I'm going to honor you with all that I am. And that meant that you were going to serve him. And that meant, in terms of the kingdom of God, you were putting your hand to the plow. Have you turned around? Are your lines straight? Are your lines straight? Jesus was saying to them, this is the real thing. But I do believe that Jesus would also have said to them, but it'll be fun. It's going to be an adventure. You're going to enjoy it. Wait, I thought Jesus told them they were going to suffer and get mutilated and mocked and scorned. And didn't he say? He did say that, but did he not also say, I don't want you to just have life. I came so that you'd have more of it. More life and what? More abundantly. What does that mean? It means he knows what you and I need, and he's well able to provide it. Adventure, believe it or not. Number two, certainty sacrificed, or confidence. You could use either word here. My second point here is sacrificing either certainty or confidence. Quick show of hands, very quickly. Quick show of hands. How many of you would say you really, really like your job? Raise your hand. Okay. Wow, the rest of you must be bummed out, huh? Okay. Now, Sam, the next part of that question is, how many of you would say, I'm really good at what I do? And this isn't being boastful, really. I like what I do, and I'm good at it. I know Fred's good at it. That's why you're overworked, poor man. All right, keep them up for a second. You're good at what you do. You're good at what you do. Now, keep them up. If you wouldn't change what you're doing, if you wouldn't do another job, keep your hand up. If you like what you're doing and you're good at it, both, right? Keep your hand up. That's several people. Several people like it. Okay, you can put your hand down. Listen, there's a story in here that talks about Jesus going to some people that were fishing. And these fishermen, they had done this their whole life. In fact, I'll read it to you. Matthew chapter 4, verse 18 to 22, chapter 4, Matthew. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew, and they were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And he told them, come and follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. Now, they might have thought to themselves for a second, what do you mean fish for people? What is this guy, a hitman? I guess he kind of looks Italian. Nope, sorry, I'm going to take that back. But they were doing what they knew how to do. That's the point I'm making, is they knew how to do what they were doing, and they liked what they did. They clearly were, it was a family endeavor. Why? Because Zebedee's their dad. He's fishing too. This was something they did. It was something they did. They knew it well, right? Let me keep reading. At once they left their net and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father, right, preparing their nets. Jesus calls them, and immediately they left the boat and their father, and they followed him. Listen, as whether it was the family business or not, whether they were good at it or not, and I think that they would be, because fishing's not an easy thing. Do it all your life, and you get pretty crafty at it, right? Rich, Fred, fishermen, people that know what to do. It's probably very euphoric. There's a lot of contentment, I think, probably satisfaction. And then bringing this big haul in and saying, hey, this works. This is fun. It's enjoyable to do something with your hands, and you see the fruit of it. And they probably, you know, there's no reason to think they didn't like what they were doing. And I'm thinking to myself, so Jesus comes and asks them, and they're like, whoop, goodbye. And they take off. What's Dad thinking? What's Zebedee thinking? I'm thinking to myself now, did Zebedee say, guys, to his sons, what are you doing? Where are you going? I'm wondering. He's a dad. He's fishing. It's a family business. There they are, right? I'm wondering if their dad looked at them and said, folks, there's no money in this. Guys, don't be stupid. Don't be stupid. If you're a parent or a grandparent in here, listen to me very carefully right now. This is a control issue. They were willing to sacrifice their security. Mom, dad, grandparent, whatever. Listen, somebody's called to do something. You know why they followed Jesus? Because they saw something real. Zebedee might have looked at them and he might have said, no, first go get your degree. Hello? Before you follow God. Maybe you just better go to college and make your career real. Your career is important. Maybe you should do that before you follow Christ. And I know this is a sensitive subject, but it's still true. They put down what their livelihood was, and they said, this is real, and this is what Christ has called me to, and I'm going, and he'll take care of them. Do not overread what I'm saying. I am not saying college is unspiritual. I am not saying to in any way that, well, I guess I don't have to go to school. I'm just gonna, you know, play the guitar on the beaches of, no. Listen. Even as a parent, and I have little kids, and there's people here with little kids, right? And of course you want what's best for your child. But not only do I want to be able to say, and it might be a niece or a nephew in your world or a grandchild, I want to be able to say, not only, God, I'll follow you anywhere you call me to, but I want to be able to say the same thing about my boys. That's harder. That's harder. Why? Why is it harder? I don't understand. I love the Lord. I trust him fully. So why is it harder for me to say, God, if you call my boys into something other than what? Because that uncertainty is still in there. That fear is still in. Wow, are they going to feed themselves? Are they going to get married? Now, there's other reasons why he might never get married. But that's not the point. That's a whole other issue. But my point is, I want to be able to say confidently about me and my boys. Yeah. Yeah, I don't have to go back and finish anything. I have to follow Christ. Remember, we're chasing the lion. It's a different type of series. You're thinking about where your life is right now. That's the point. So God will call you to do what he called them to do, and that is release something. What? I don't know. God is going to call you to do the same thing that he asked of them. He's going to call you to let something go. It's how he builds me. It's how he makes me stronger. When he makes me to understand that when I sacrifice something I don't need, I get stronger in him. I grow closer to him. I get better. When he helps me to understand, let that thing go. It's not helpful to you. It's not a benefit to you. He wants your faithfulness. Please don't get offended with me right now. Please don't get offended with me. Your mouth might say that your priorities are this and this, but if I see your calendar and your schedule and your checkbook, I'll tell you what your priorities are. I don't mean to offend anyone. I know we all get busy. I get that. But we can tell what's important to you by where we spend our money and where we spend our time. So if with my mouth I say I'm fully and wholly devoted to the Lord, but with my life I don't see that, then there's a problem. There's a disconnect. And maybe during these weeks that we've been preaching and praying, we go back to the drawing board and we go back to the Lord and say, you know what? If I'm saying that I'm completely sold out, then my checkbook and my schedule and my calendar and, you know, all of that, my social media, hello, ought to reflect that. It has to match what comes out of my mouth and what's in reality happening. All right, let me move on. We can put a lot of stuff in front of Jesus. We can put an awful lot of stuff and call it important, and they're not bad things. They might be good things, but we can put an awful lot of stuff in front of Jesus. And don't get me wrong, Jesus doesn't make you throw away good things. He'll shuffle around what he needs to shuffle. He doesn't, you know, people seem to think that, well, I put my kids first and, you know, and then Jesus. And I'm thinking, if I put Jesus first and then my kids, it's better because Jesus will take care of my kids. And he does this better than I do. So don't think that I'm not asking. I mean, people get offended about this stuff. Let me be careful. People get offended about this stuff. If I say, I'm going to be candid with you. You take Johnny to baseball practice and he never comes to church on a Wednesday Bible study. Guess what you're teaching him? That baseball's more important than Bible study. Now listen. Please, there are people that do sports and football and whatever else and, you know, cheerleading or whatever it is. Yeah, she still calls that a sport, whatever. I'm so kidding. Oh, I'm going to get lynched. I'm kidding. I'm joking. I'm going to duck. No, I'm joking. Listen, sports are good things, including cheerleading. Sports are good things. They're not bad things. But if I teach my son or my daughter, or it might be something else, it doesn't have to be athletics. It might be band practice or this thing that they do. And they're missing church and they're over here and they're over there. What am I instilling in them? What am I teaching them to do? I'm teaching them that, you know what? It's okay to get yourself so busy that you can't serve God fully. And oh, do I know what that looks like. And so do we all, don't we? So what I'm saying is, if we're sold out, then we're sold out. And if we're going to do that, God may ask you, remember how this started? God may ask you to let something go. He may say, I know that's important to you. And I know that's a good thing. But I'm asking you to let that go and follow me. Okay, moving on. I would just ask you, speaking of things that God might let you to ask you to let go, do the five or six closest friends of yours, the five or six closest people to you, do they draw you nearer to Christ or away? Maybe it's time to shift some things around. Now listen, if it's your spouse, you're married. If I see a spouse tomorrow at the church with their suitcase, I'd be like, I'm supposed to sleep here? My wife gave me away? No. No, you're missing the point. I'm talking about the people that we hang with, the people that we're friends with, the people that we spend our time with, that consume our attention, and we do whatever. You're going to go to a movie, you're going to go with them. You're going to go out to eat, you're going to go with them. If it's a game or what have you, what kind of person are they? Are you blessing them? Are you drawing them toward Christ, or are they pulling you away? God may ask you to let something go. Let me move on. Ecclesiastes 11:4. I want to ask you this. Perhaps God has truly been asking you to press in, to serve him in a different way, a better way, to serve him more, and maybe do something really courageous to serve him and to honor him, something you're nervous about. Maybe it's about getting involved in a ministry, but you're just not sure that you can because you're so busy. And he's saying, let it go so that you can serve me, so that you can follow me. Whatever that looks like, I don't know what it looks like for you. I can't know what that looks like for you exactly. God has to speak that to you. And he's asking you, be brave, step out, do this. Remember, chasing the lion. It's not an easy thing. It might take a little guts. It might to serve him better, lion chasing. And if you wait for the perfect moment, it'll never happen. Ministry doesn't work like that, right? You're very involved. Listen, you don't say, well, as soon as I have enough time, then I'll get involved. You'll never get involved. And I don't want to speak negativity into your life. Forgive me. I don't want to be critical right now, but if you hope for the atmospheric conditions to be just right, it's not going to happen. In our house, we have two loud, you know, raucous boys and a wife. and I didn't say raucous. I know, and a wife. So I'm saying, so there's four of us. Did that not come out right? Listen, the point is, and I'm louder than, listen, you know I'm louder than she is. I love her, and I love that she's a bundle of illustrations for me to use. So our kitchen is sort of cavernous, and the sound echoes like crazy. So you got all this crazy, oh my goodness, noise and whatever. And a lot of times the boys are crabby and cranky. And I find, or sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're giddy and happy as clams. But I find that the noise and the crazy, all this echoey, clanging back. And I find that it makes me grumpy. And so my task, did you just wave your hand? Of all the Sundays, you're always with the kids helping. All of a sudden, you got to like study my sermon. Whatever. It's fine. No problem. Is my suitcase out front? Whatever. Thank you, Dennis. Anyway, I don't know. She don't need your help. She doesn't need your help. All right. So the thing is, I have to understand that my house might be noisy, and if I'm waiting for it to be quiet and peaceful and, you know, crickets in the background or birds chirping outside. If that's what I'm waiting on, if I'm waiting for the atmospheric conditions to be just right for me to be happy, it'll never happen. Serving the Lord is the same way. If you're waiting for everything to be at ease, all is well, how am I doing financially? Good, everything good, family's well, okay. Now I think I can call the pastor and say, I could come help. Listen, Ecclesiastes 11:4, if you're there, says this: whoever watches the wind will not plant, and whoever looks at the clouds will not reap. What does it mean? It means if you're waiting for the right opportunity, when God is saying, will you please step in? I have a plan for you. I have an adventure for you. I have something good for you to do to be fruitful. Will you please, over the next couple days, even the next couple minutes, just begin asking him, is there something I need to let go so that I can do this better? So that I can honor you, so I can serve you? What do I got to let go? God gives us adventure because he loves us. But he asks us, point number two, to sacrifice some of that confidence. He does. To give control to him. My third point is a wild goose chase. You knew I was going to talk about meat eventually, didn't you? No, but that's not where this is going. We're not eating the goose. As little kids, it's this instinctive thing to chase butterflies. Right? If you're Jaden, you're going to catch them. You're going to pet them. You're going to love them. If you're Julian, you're going to kill them. But the point is, as little kids, we have this instinctive need. I make that poor kid out to sound so bad. He's really not. He's great. I love Julian. Anyway, there's this instinctive need as a little kid to chase these bugs or these butterflies. And then we get a little older and we're chasing toys or whatever. And then we get to teenage years and you're chasing girls or boys. Again, that other sermon that we'll get to in months. And as we get older, we begin to chase other things, chase academics. Maybe we do chase athletics or these artistic goals or a degree. Or we get dreams. We think, here's what I'm going to do. We have this vision in our head. Maybe a spouse is in there, right, somewhere to chase after. And then there's positions to look for and even authority and things that are meaningful. And there are seasons in our life as we age that we begin to seek something else. Before a certain age, it might be just stability and finance. And then eventually, if that comes, we have family. And then you start to seek, well, how can I be meaningful and authority and lead? You know, there's different things that we seek in your lifespan. You look for different things. The thing is, eventually you settle down. Many times we settle down and we have our family and we had what we think we were going to get. And the career that we thought might happen didn't happen. And we're doing something else, but we're okay. And maybe the dream or that vision is kind of gone, right? And it fades. In fact, most of our visions and our dreams and our plans of grandeur don't usually come out exactly the way we meant them to come out. And in Proverbs 29:18, it tells me that when visions and dreams and that goal, when it fades, people perish. People perish. But conspicuously missing from the list of things that I suggested we chase was the Lord. Conspicuously missing from the list of things that we chase was, God, what do you want me to do? What's your plan for me? What's your vision for me? Because his vision for you will never fade. It will shift. It will change. The dynamics of what God will do in your life won't always stay the same, but it will never die, and it will never pass. It will never fade, what God has for you to do. So the question is, do you know what that is? When you look at your life, when you look at what you do, you say to yourself, well, yeah, the word does say that he has a plan for my life. Everyone, not just me, not just somebody in ministry. Everyone, God has a plan to prosper you, right? Jeremiah, my favorite verse, plans to bless you, to help you, to prosper you. There's a plan for you to be busy and fruitful and all of that. Do you know what it is? Because if you don't know what it is, then I would suggest you don't have a vision that's not going to fade. Whatever vision you've got that you're pursuing, if it's not from God, eventually it won't please you. You may even get there. You may even get what you're chasing for. You may even get what you're chasing for. But in the end, it's what God gives you to do, to be, that will make you happy, that will fulfill you, that will fill you full of peace and full of joy. And even when the uncertainty is still there, you can still sit back and say, no, I don't know what's happening tomorrow. But guess what? It doesn't matter. I don't care. It doesn't matter, right? God, what do you want from me? This reason it was named Wild Goose is because pursuing what God wants for me sometimes feels like chasing the wind. Some of you may be in here saying, Pastor, I got involved in ministry. I used to do this. I used to do ministry forever. I did that ministry for 10 years, 15 years. What happened? God's vision doesn't fade. His plan doesn't fade. If you were fruitful then, you should be fruitful now. There's no reason to stop. And God might have moved you or shifted something around, but I would encourage, I would dare say, some of us need to say, God, I was, and now I'm not, and I want to again. That's what I would suggest we should be saying to God. It is, and this applies to me too, because I can get comfortable with what I do too. I can get lazy in what I do too. Pastor, you're in ministry, yeah? And you still begin to go through motions and realize, no, I want something fresh. God, am I doing exactly what you want me to do? I don't want to do the same old thing. I want to do the best thing. And God, if there's something I'm doing within this church, whether it's a ministry or something I like to do or read or watch, and maybe it's a good thing, maybe it's a spiritual thing, maybe it's a ministry-related thing, and God says to me, stop. That's not best. It's good, but it's not what I want for you, because best is better than good. So let me say this again. I've said it many times. Good is the enemy of best. What I have that I'm doing, I like it, I'm comfortable, don't mess with this, God. And God is saying, even though it looks good, let it go. I have better. This is hard to hear. Let me move on. It's like chasing the wind. It's like chasing the wind, and we don't get to control our path, so it gets a little nerve-wracking. And when we don't get to control our path, it gets a little unnerving. And you say, you know what? Well, God doesn't leave you dangling in the wind. That's ridiculous. God keeps you stable and safe and knowing what's around. No, he doesn't. He doesn't keep you knowing what's around the bend. He fills you with confidence and with peace. He does. But listen to John 3:8. Here's what Jesus said to them, in case you're wondering. John 3:8, the wind blows wherever it passes. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from, and you don't know where it's going either. And then he says, so it is with everyone born of the Spirit. What does that mean? It means, God, whatever you want to do. Today, I'm doing this. Right now, I'm doing this. My hands to the plow. I'm going straight. I'm not going to change it. I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to serve, but I will constantly be asking God, am I following you? Am I really doing what you want me to do? Now, the good news is this. Even though he might move you from one important thing to another, or he might move you from a place of comfort to a place of discomfort and challenge so that he can grow you and make you be better and make you be more fruitful, there might be a lot of change, but here's the good news. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So he's always going to be faithful. So I never have to worry. Luke chapter 9, verse 3, they're traveling, they're doing their thing. He told them, take nothing for the journey, no staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra shirt. Let's just go. But it's God saying that. I wouldn't say that without God. I wouldn't say that without God. Why does that matter? Why are you saying that? Because there are people who just jump into something and they have not asked God. If it's God leading me, and that's where discernment comes in, which is where prayer and the reading the word is so important, because you're not going to, hear me, you're not going to have the discernment and the wisdom of God if you're not talking to him. And the way to do that is prayer and the word of God. You can be as spiritual as you want. You can be miles wide and about an inch deep if you're not in the Word and in prayer. But if you are in the Word and in prayer, then He'll lead you. And then there's no reason for me to worry about what I'm taking with me. My final point, crash. That's my final point, in case you're writing it down. A group of fishes called a school, and I'll rush through here. I'm coming in for landing. A group of fishes called a school. Ants are called colonies. Bees are a swarm. Cattle, thank God for cattle. Cattle are herds. What? Birds are flocks. Does anyone, just out of curiosity, know what a group of buzzards is called? Where's Sharon O'Hara? No? She's a birder. She's not in here today. She's away. What? No. Okay. No, Sharon O'Hara. Yeah, the birder. Yeah. I love Sharon. She'd know. A group of buzzards is called a committee. I'm not kidding. Isn't that great? That's hysterical. I totally agree. Isn't that funny? And I'm not making this up. This is actually out of an etymology book. This is a real thing. I'm not making it up. You can Google this. A committee. Isn't that hysterical? Anyway, I'm not saying committees are always unspiritual. I'm just saying they equate very closely with buzzards. So is that worse or better? Probably worse. My personal favorite, though, is this. A group of rhinos. A group of rhinos is called a crash. Do you know why? Because a rhino can run 30 miles an hour. That's about 5 miles an hour faster than squirrels. Now, I want you to envision your lawn. On one morning, you come out. You know how you see the squirrels running crazy? Picture it with rhinos running even faster. Now, they're heavy, so it changes the dynamic a little bit. Listen, in a straight line, 30 miles an hour, that's fast. 30 miles an hour is fast in a straight line. Try it later. Don't hurt yourself. They're faster than squirrels, etc. But here's the funniest thing. This is how I know God has a sense of humor, because He created them, right? They can't see. They're blind. Rhinos see only 30 feet in front of them. They can barely see. They can see from here to the wall, and that's it. Why would God make something that weighs that much and runs that fast not be able to see? Listen, because on their head, there is a giant bony plate and a protective horn. And even if they do, they'll take out a tree before they get hurt. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that interesting? I want you to think about what God is saying. God will move you as fast as He wants to move you. He is your shield. He does not make anything by accident. If He made a rhino to go 30 miles an hour and not get hurt when crashing into something, then He made me to go the speed that He made me to go to, and He's going to protect me. He's not going to let me get hurt. He's not going to let you get hurt. Do you understand what I'm saying? Amen. Let's wrap it up. We're done. I just want to say, I want that to sink in. I want that to sink in. We're talking about chasing the lion. I know I'm going long. We're done. Listen, God has a plan for you. He's got a plan for your life. He's got something that you need to do. And we're gonna end with the music in the back there, Ruben, if you want to cue something up. But I, of course, as always, if you need prayer, come on up. Worship was a sweet place to put that as well. But listen, I want you to let this sink in when you leave here. What's the plan? What's the plan for your life? What's the vision for your life? Maybe you're doing something and you should say to God, is this it? Is this right? Am I doing the right thing? Have you been in the Word? Have you been in prayer? Do you already know as I'm talking, I know what I need to let go. I already know what I'm supposed to let go to follow Him. I just don't want to do it. I'm finding it difficult. I like what I do. I like what I have. The future may be uncertain, but he's asking you for more. He's asking you to chase the line. He's asking you to run towards something that looks very dangerous. He's not asking you to creep up to it. He's asking you to sprint towards something that looks like something you don't want, but to trust Him in the process. It will change you. It will change you. Stand with me. Lord, thank You so much for Your grace. Thank You so much for Your faithfulness. There is no doubt that You protect Your people. You provide Your people. You do all that we need. God, I pray as we began the service with these words, with these thoughts, increase our gratitude. Fill us so full of thanks and so full of gratitude that we can't help but chase after you and say, God, how can I honor you better? How can I serve you more? With all of my uncertainties, my trust grows. The more doubt I might have, the more I trust you, Lord. Father, I thank you for this time. I thank you for this moment that your Spirit is speaking to our hearts. I pray that it would not be the end of a service, but the beginning of a dialogue between the Holy Spirit and us. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. Protect your people. Bring us back on Wednesday night for Bible study. God, if we got to move work or shift things around, we want to honor you and serve you more. Help us to do that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.